I'll now move on to the next session on renewables financing and investment. And ladies and gentlemen, privilege for me to have such an such a high level set of speakers for this, enlightening us. May I invite our session chair and moderator, Mr. Vishnu Jerome. He's a founding partner from JMP Law. Mr. Karan Mitru, partner from Utsain Lutra. Mr. Harvinder Singh, Assistant Vice President, Tata Cleantech Capital Limited. Ma'am Rukum Gautam, Head Asset Management from GreenMax Solar. Mr. Onkar Kapoor, CEO, PVEV Renewables. Mr. Abhilak Singh, GM from IREDA. Mr. Devi Prashad, Executive Director from IEASA. Tanya Batra from Grant Thornton. And Mr. Gautam Samanta from Orange Renewables. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome them with a big round of applause.
So good afternoon to all of you. We do have a very distinguished panel, and it's representative of bankers, private equity players, developers, and therefore, I think the aim of this session would be to get each of their perspective on the state of debt and other types of financing that are available today, steps that we could incorporate within our laws and the general environment to improve access to debt and other sorts of financing, and experiences from some of the developers, like Kapoor, etc., on raising of financings in their very niche areas of business. We have one interesting topic towards the end on use of technology in new businesses and raising financing in this sector. I'll start with Mr. Abhilak Singh first, and the reason, sir, really is that the Indian market has had a lot of debt instruments which are mature, right? So we have loan facilities, you had a bond market, you had partial credit guarantees of some sort being given by either the state or otherwise green bonds, the funds, etc. So the framework is in place. But of course the ease of access and ease of getting that debt hasn't really occurred for most of the players, especially the SME players. One of the questions that I wanted to ask you is, what steps would you take, and two, do you believe now is the time that there has to be a more direct impact by the government in terms of actually saying interest subsidy on a centralized basis, and them to give more subventions, and government really stepping in to reduce and incentivize, to reduce interest costs and to incentivize, for example, you reduce minimum average costs in the ECB regime to allow people to access debt. So just wanted your thoughts on that, what the government could do, or is it just the private sector?
Good afternoon to everyone. So very typical questions is asked. Actually, I am the first speaker. As far as government concern, subsidies are very limited for particular purpose. So as of now, it is restricted to only solar rooftop and some other schemes. Apart from it, there is a subsidy, CFA, Central Financing Assistance, which is called now in place of subsidy. So that is only available being developed by center along with the state. So one park is already working very fine, and some more are coming up. So there is some subsidy or Central Financing Assistance is available for solar park developers. So I don't think there is actually finance is available for directly for developers, except in domestic sector of rooftop solar, and maybe for concentrated solar thermal. That is very small applications. I don't think we have done much in that, and amount wise also is a very small. Of course, there is in other sector also subsidy wherever it is required. But as far as IREDA is concerned, IREDA is totally actually a funding agency. So there is no question of subsidy. But of course, we are actually administrator for one is the generation waste incentive, which is being actually provided for, if you remember, recall, 2010 when a scheme came up when just solar mission was launched. So that is still continuing, and that is 17 rupees per unit. So out of that, that was the maximum ceiling, and 12 rupees per unit now also being given by Government of India through IREDA. And that commitment is still, and it will continue up to 2035 or 36, depending upon the agreement signed between the individuals, developers. Another generation-based incentive is available for wind sector, that is a 50 paisa per unit for whatever the power is generated and fed to the grid. So that scheme also being administered by IREDA. And those two schemes, actually, there is no issue actually getting the funds and all. And though few years back we had a problem, that government has sorted out. Then there are actually, we always try to innovate some ideas, how to actually bring the better way, how to reduce the interest cost. So interest cost, actually, now it all directly depends upon what is our actually cost of fund. So it will be directly proportionate to that. So at present, IREDA's maximum actually funding is through international funding, through all bilateral and multilateral agencies. And then the cheapest one is only the through bond market, which we have actually drawn, and in future also we will continue. So perhaps that is the only cheapest one which can make actually some sort of a concession, or we can bring in down the interest cost. And as a matter of fact, when the most of the banks were increasing the interest rate, at that time also we kept, or even we reduced also. If you see in last 3-4 years, there is a trend that we keep on reducing. And last was reduced sometimes in number 18, 6 months back. And perhaps in future also, if there is a trend, because last credit committee, credit review by RBI, they have also reduced some rates. So if that actually happens, so perhaps we have to actually find out the sources where we can also raise that cheaper rate.
Mr. Kapoor, let me just ask you the question. As a developer, a promoter, cost of funding is the biggest challenge as far as raising debt is concerned, as far as lenders giving debt is concerned. So do you believe that more direct intervention is required? What is done is sufficient? Because it still doesn't seem to be collocating as far as debt is concerned. And, you know, your experiences on that front, or what your perspective there.
So basically, issue is, either it is a government PPA or it is a third party PPA, the payment is an issue. So due to that, interest costs and other costs are high. So if in India, as a like a bond market, we will create some discount buying market, like a purchase of the bills. So we need some type of mechanism there. And yes, so if you are getting some interest rate and 6 months you are not getting the payment, every calculation on Excel, we need basically some mechanism where we will sign the developer has signed the PPA either with the government or third party, and they will submit the bill and discounting will be take place. So one thing is that it will ensure that no IPP company will become NPA type scenarios, or total impact will be, from my point of view, will be minimum 100 to 200 BPS lower as impact.
Regarding this payment issue, now actually we have started some short-term loan to the discounts. And that loan we have released, I think, last financial year, good amount. And we are trying actually impress upon this discounts that at least they should actually means cover our borrowers also, so that this NPA can be avoided. So, and then we are also trying to impress upon the DISCOMs, once release the money, then it should be used for only renewable energy instead of their general purpose and all. So just before coming here, one issue came. So then one of the senior officers, he was doubting whether they will use for this money for the payment of their salary, etc. So some mechanism we should develop so that this money should be strictly should go to the only developers.
That's a interesting perspective. And just before I come to the rest of the panel, you know, on the aspect that Mr. Kapoor spoke about, which was receivables, discounting, and you know, the securitization market that Tata Capital and your group companies are involved in, do you see that market, the PTC market, being a better source of funding for companies such as this? Because, you know, the receivable will come, and I think last panel also discussed not just the receivables, but also, you know, GST refunds, whether you can actually securitize, STG, whether you can securitize. So I think your perspective, given that you're in that market and a buyer, would be interesting.
So before answering your question, just want to say something on subsidy part. I think the Indian grid connected solar market is now mature enough to have any subsidy. The market has been more than subsidy. What they need is policy certainty on the government side, because as a developer or as a financier, the biggest joker in the block is the policy, which keeps with time keeps changing. Something keep new things keep coming, and the entire calculation go haywire. Like the receivable thing, what you have said, just to come on that. So receivable banks or financial institutions can securitize receivables if there is a definite timeline to that. You can see in case of discounts like Telangana and others, we can give a 6-month discounting facility to our borrowers, where we have a certainty that money will come in 5 months, 6 months, but the receivables reach a level of 9 months, even 12 months. So securitization of these receivables of other assets can work, but if there's some sort of certainty there, some fixed timelines are there. For a financier, for a financing institution, you want some certainty in terms of timelines for the discounting any receivable, a PTC or anything. So other market that can develop is like, we can say a market, like we can, as of now, the very few commercial banks are financing these projects, because the commercial bank have a challenge of asset liability mismatch. They have a book, they are in a book for 6 to 7 years, they can finance for 6 to 7 years. So what we need, some sort of an institution, large government corporate institution, which can take out these banks after financing the construction part of the project. So once the project becomes stable, from my understanding, a solar project, once it's stabilized, it's like a fixed return project, like an annuity project. If it is maintained properly with a decent O&M thing, it will give you annuity. So we need some institution which can, or some sort of, we want some pension funds, some mutual funds to come up and invest in these assets, so they can offload the bank's balance sheet and banks can finance new projects. That itself will reduce the cost of financing for the developers. So this is my suggestion on this. Instead of subsidy, some innovative financing method should be there. Subsidies won't be able to help this sector much.
You know, before I move into some of the other more weightier legal issues which have happened in the last year or so, I just wanted to get Mr. Devi Prasad's view, you know, from a international perspective, working with the alliance. You know, there have been, you know, impact bonds, for example, which have financed renewable projects abroad. There are certain of those funds which are coming into India today. Do you see them play a larger role along with the domestic institutions in financing, you know, various types of, probably more in the SME sector, but such types of, you know, renewable energy projects?
Okay, so I will not majorly focus on the renewable space, but the new upcoming space like hybrid projects and hybrid plants, which is both from the point of view of commercial industrial segment and also on the grid scale. If you see the market for last 3-4 years, yes, on hybrid project like solar, wind plus battery storage projects, there are many projects have cancelled. But in last 6 months, few of the project has given allocation to different companies to take ahead and doing the projects. And in last 3 months, few announcement has been done. But there are two major models come up in India. One is like viability gap funding. If you go for the recent project which is released by SECI, it's like they have a fixed price on total generation of solar plus batteries, and they are giving a viability gap funding, whichever will give a lower price bid, then they will allocate that. And the second way is like there is a technical bid and then there is a reverse auction. But surprisingly, the players in the Indian market who are bidding for these hybrid renewable projects, they have different calculations. Just giving two examples, one of the project which is just a battery project in Delhi, recently inaugurated in January, a 10 megawatt project. If you know the cost, it's around 10 million, which is around 65 crores to 100 crores. And it's in Delhi. So the per megawatt cost will be around 6 to 7 crores. But surprisingly, on the other side, when a company is bidding a project, the winning bid for a Leh project is around 2.94 crores for a 1 megawatt project. So there is a huge gap when someone is bidding for a 3 crores for 1 megawatt, another company is doing a project at 6 crores. The reason is there is no good calculations on the project side. They're not analyzing the risk involved in a new type of hybrid projects. Is there a battery maintenance need to be done? Because this huge gap from 3 crores to 6 crores in a single megawatt project is not creating a sustainable market. And few of the companies, I don't want to mention the names, they're actually cutting the price of the hybrid project. They should not go the same way how solar industry is going, because solar industry, there are like sub 3 rupees prices are floating in the market, and many of the projects are unviable at that price. So at the nascent stage of these hybrid projects, we should not see these things are happening, because globally the price fall of the projects has not happened like this. If you go for any of the projects in Germany or Australia or in US, the prices are directly in the market driven. So the companies like Nextera or AES or whoever doing this energy storage integrated renewable project, they never beat such prices. So it's a concern to all the companies who are in renewables, because every day and night we're getting queries from these renewable companies to diversify to hybrid projects, and they should bid for, because recently there is open bid for Lakshadweep. It's a floating solar plus energy storage. Similarly, there is REIL, another project for Andaman. So there are multiple projects are happening. So be cautious on the price side, evaluate your risk very strongly. Don't go ahead like as a fast mover advantage to take the process at any price, then you will cry for the implementations. So this is on a concern on not individually renewable project, but as a hybrid project where storage is involved.
I think both Gautam and Mr. Kapoor were nodding and smiling at most of the observations. So I don't know if you have any response immediately, Gautam. Okay, Mr. Kapoor.
Hi, Gautam this side. Basically what Devi has already pointed out, particularly on the risk assessment, you know, this kind of the new technologies, like so far we are more experienced on the ground mounted project, something like 28 gigawatt we have installed. As far as the roof is concerned, I think it is less than 2 gigawatt. But the new technologies, particularly on the floating one which is coming, so the maturity is not there. So we have to understand, you know, compared to the ground mounted in the floating, what are the differences? Say for example, if the wind speed is more than 100 kilometer per hour, you know, how the floater, you know, though there is a good anchoring systems, you know, but how it will work, you know, will there be bulging and overlapping so that it destroy all of your, you know, the modules, you know, so the working bay and all. But from the generation perspective, definitely floating at least, you know, is a much better than the ground mounted, as well as in the rooftop. You know, in rooftop also there is an issue, like, you know, in the ground mounted the breeze is blowing, you know, therefore you get a temperature, you know, which is an advantage. But in the rooftop, sometimes the gap between your, you know, the module and what you install, you know, the generations, what we do in the PV system analysis, but actually it is not happening. Coming back to the new technology area, which Devi has already mentioned on the hybrid and the storage, you know, as you know, storage is as on date is like $150 a kilowatt hour, and that is only storage part. But if you add the other equipments as well, is something like $200 per kilowatt hour. So when we sign the new PPA, particularly how to utilize your, you know, the 24 hours in the grid, you know. So if there is a solar in the daytime and then the evening time, something like, you know, if you have your wind as well, and the storage part is coming particularly on the peak hours, you know, where we have a We need a more power, particularly in 6 to 9 in the evening or in the morning, like 8 to 10. So there it is viable. So you have to understand the new technology, but we have to calculate in terms of the pricing as well. So what will be my, you know, per kilowatt or per unit generations. So looking into the new technologies, I think there are a lot of scope, but we have to be a bit careful in bidding in terms of the pricing. We should not go for the lowest price, and because the market is not matured in a particularly on the new technologies, right? But there are several other technology we'll talk in a later stage, you know. Thank you.
Yes, I think we'll come back to some other sources of financing, you know, shortly. I just wanted to bring Karan, who works, you know, on the contracts and the legal side of the entire financing space. So, Karan, I think this year has been very eventful. A lot has happened on the insolvency and restructuring side. A few changes on the ECB regime. So, I think first, if you could, you know, just let us know in terms of transactions that you see, you know, are investors comfortable as far as quality of your quality of our judicial system is concerned, enforcement of contracts? Where do you see that has, you know, has that improved over the last year and a half? Because you deal with a lot of foreign investors and domestic lenders in this space.
Thanks, Vishnu. So, I mean, the biggest change we have seen in India is the GST and the IBC coming on board. And both have the same problem of good intent, but bad implementation. So like GST, you know, initially when it came about, there was no systems in place, which is why there were a lot of losses that a lot of these transport companies were incurring. IBC was a solid code, but a few factors were not thought through very carefully, because of which its implementation was in doubt. So there's some of these big cases which are lingering on for more than 2 years, handling a few of them personally. But all in all, the IBC law seems to have settled, and that has provided a lot of confidence to foreign investors and lenders, because now they have a direct recourse in a time-bound manner. The biggest problem in India was that no lender had enforcement achievement in a time-bound manner. The IBC has sort of changed that perception about the Indian market. So from a lender perspective, they've got a lot of comfort with the coming in of the IBC, and the law is maturing, and over the years, it should only become better. The bigger issue that I see still now is enforcement of construction contracts, because a lot of these construction contracts don't have arbitration. They have jurisdiction of the particular country, and we've recently seen the MNRE itself giving a guideline saying that ex-Chinese player defaulted. Because of the default, although we got an enforcement award, the execution did not happen in China, which basically means that I won the case, but when I go to China to enforce where the company is lying, they've refused, and the ministries of both China and India have got involved. So enforcement of these contracts seems to be a bit of a challenge. We don't really pay attention to that clause when we're negotiating the warranties, you know, from a commercial perspective, although legally it's always advised. So I think that is one sphere where there's a lot that can be done, not only by choosing arbitration, which is the faster recourse process, but also at the government level. The government intervention would be required to get the benefit from non-cooperative entities located outside India. And I think that is where the government needs to play a key role, which it has already sort of done with these one or two Chinese suppliers. Moving on to the ECB regulations, the law in India needs to sort of increase and enhance the liquidity funding into India. Unfortunately, what has happened in this ECB guideline is that refinancing of rupee debt, which was earlier permitted under a particular track, has been stopped. The logic for that, we don't know. But what that will do is it will dry out the ECB funding which was coming for refinancing these rupee projects, which seems to be a big bane in this particular sector, because there is a lot of financing required in this sector to meet the targets. There are a lot of players who are actively scouting for lower cost funding, and as someone on the previous panel also said, most of the financing today in this sector is coming from the NBFC space. The PSU banks have sort of dried up, primarily because of IBC. This is a phase, I think, another next 2 or 3 years, we should see that funding rise again, but not immediately. So the powerful players in domestic financing in India, guys like IREDA, PFC, REC, or L&T, and of course, Tata. But you need a lot more of this financing with the kind of bidding that is happening and with the kind of targets that this country has set. And for that, you need to be liberalizing the ECB regime and not sort of, weakening it for these refinancing issues.